return to CNN and Entertainment Weekly with Willow Bay and Judd Rose.
Now, a look at a band that's on tour for the first time since the early 80s. They were the talk of last month's American Music Awards, and just days from now, they'll release their new CD. Blondie is back. In case you don't recall, Blondie's first flirtation with fame in the 70s was big news. The blonde in Blondie, lead singer Debbie Harry, was a face you saw everywhere. Then, in 1982, they vanished. Newsstand's Robin Groth now with a look at how Blondie is returning to its roots.
With smash hit singles like Heart of Glass and Hanging on the Telephone, Blondie left an indelible mark on American pop music. 1978's Parallel Lines is still regarded as one of the great rock albums of all time.
Those songs, those shows, the way she projected them, the way they backed her up, the way they played as a unit was really what captivated people's attention.
Deborah Harry and her boyfriend Chris Stein started the band in 1974 with Jimmy Destri on keyboards and Clem Burke on drums. In the age of supergroups like Foreigner, Journey, and the Eagles, they were musical outsiders. Charter members of New York's punk rock scene. Harry's cool, sensual presence on stage and in videos like Detroit 442 catapulted Blondie's appeal far beyond their original cult audience. Their 1981 hit Rapture was the first rap song ever to hit the top of the pop music charts.
Hands on the ground and out comes the man from Mars.
The ingenuity of the music, the way they were able to incorporate rap and disco and punk and the girl group thing, the garage rock thing, all of that stuff into 2 and 3 minute songs.
By the early 80s, Blondie had sold over 25 million albums, scoring 4 number one singles in America and 6 in the United Kingdom, including Dreaming. But at the peak of their commercial success, the band split up and walked away from it all. 16 years later, the founding members of Blondie are ready to pick up where they left off.
We didn't want to just be, sort of drag our old clothes out of the closet and put them on and stand around and do what we did, you know, 15 years ago.
Blondie is filming this music video here in a loft in their hometown, New York City. The song is Maria, the CD, No Exit. The first one Blondie has released in 16 years.
I think to really make us work as a group and as people, we had to do something new. We had to have a little challenge.
The band has already begun a world tour to support the new album. Fans here in London see it mostly as a chance to get that blast from the past they've been longing for.
So it's just a total nostalgia trip tonight, yeah.
I'm 36 now, and the last 20 years, they've meant everything, really. The music, the culture, everything.
I wanted to marry her when I was a little boy.
I wanted to marry her as well.
I think that we're going to give them what they want in every way.
But there are questions about whether the faithful are ready to receive new music.
This is really cool, man.
And whether a new generation of listeners will be interested in a wiser but older Blondie.
I mean, is nostalgia, are the baby boomers, is that going to be enough? And is the fact that she's 53 going to hurt them?
The fact is that as a performer, Deborah Harry is still Deborah Harry, the same way Tina Turner is still Tina Turner. I don't see anyone, you know, running away from the box office when the Stones go on tour.
Good, thank you. Yes, this is our little Blondie reunion here. Finally got it together. All right, the next song is called Maria.
I think
think it was probably always in the back of our minds that perhaps someday we would get back together. And this time actually seems as good a time as any to do it.
I didn't actually think it was the right time to do this. I didn't know if there was ever going to be a right time to do this.
I would have not liked to be 10 years down the line hence and then say, like, oh, I could have done that 10 years ago, but I didn't do it, and I should have done it. Oh, it's hard. It's hard. There used to be guys behind me with cigarettes and booze. Now they're behind me with, like, oxygen and, you know, little towelettes. And the show's only 30 more minutes, Jim. You can do it. You can do it.
I didn't think that I really wanted to, you know, bring back that sort of Blondie character. But I'm really enjoying it.
For the band, getting to this point meant getting over some painful history, like the belief that many rock and roll critics never supported them.
Our earlier records really kind of assimilated a lot of different things that most people weren't particularly interested in at the time.
The public's fascination with Deborah Harry only fueled the critical backlash.
Debbie really got slammed. People really don't realize how much negative criticism we got for her being overtly sexual when she was doing even less than what the guys were all getting away with, you know. Mick Jagger, et cetera, and so forth.
What she was doing at a time when the idea of being strong and sensual was kind of perceived as a threat to a very male-dominated and increasingly corporatized record industry.
Blondie also fell victim to a familiar rock and roll problem.
We were never paid like we should have been paid, and it's a general assumption that, you know, we got ripped off for a lot of money.
Relations between the band members were seriously strained by the time of their 1982 tour. The final blow came after Chris Stein, seen here in Blondie Live, was hospitalized with a rare, life-threatening genetic illness. Deborah Harry stood by her longtime partner and nursed him back to health, but that two-year process, coupled with the group's emotional burnout, brought an end to the first chapter of Blondie's career.
We had worked very hard for about 7 years, somewhere between 5 and 7 years, without really stopping, and it became too much pressure.
During their lengthy hiatus from Blondie, Clem Burke worked with the Eurythmics and the Romantics. Jimmy Destri cut an album and produced other performers. And though their romance ended after his recovery, Chris Stein and Deborah Harry continued on as close friends and musical collaborators. Harry released several solo albums and began to explore new musical frontiers.
And I can merengue, and I'll never learn.
Most recently with a New York-based combo called the Jazz Passengers. In a way, Harry thinks that all the detours helped Blondie achieve a level of status they'd never had, even at the height of their fame.
I think in retrospect, Blondie's reputation has grown actually for not working, for not performing, and not being out there, which says something really, I think it says a lot for the music.
I missed out the first time seeing them around because I was too young. And I was thinking I was going to be disappointed, but it was brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
I think it's so fantastic that they're still oh, so yeah. Great and big, and it's amazing.
There are still, like, a lot of hardcore Blondie fans alive.
Thank you.
I think that, you know, the odds are good because they are good songwriters. They're a good band, they're a great band, and they can play.
But how long can they keep it up this time?
That is the big question. And of course, you had to ask it. I don't know, you know, I guess that sort of just remains to be seen.
Thank you.
By the way, Deborah Harry is set to star in a new independent film called 6 Ways to Sunday. She plays, and here's creative casting, a lounge singer. Blondie's new album, No Exit, comes out next Tuesday, and a single from that album, Maria, entered the British charts at number one. Looks like Blondie is set to recapture the rapture.